Can I share a little thought with you? Let's go to 1 Peter 5. 1 Peter 5. Some of you take notes and write things down. Just close your notebook, put your pen up. You won't be able to follow along on notebook paper. I'm going to give you a little thought this morning, encourage your hearts. Appreciate the Lord coming back.
Amen.
Glad He's here this morning. Nothing like when the Lord shows up. And you say, "Oh, preacher, I don't feel nothing." Well, you sitting in the wrong pew, amen. I'm glad that I feel Him. I'm glad I know when He's around.
Amen.
I've been a few places where they told me He was there, and I didn't feel nothing. I'm not being critical, but I couldn't feel much going on. And that may have been something wrong with me. It may not have been the place I was at, but I'm glad I can feel Him this morning, and I'm glad I'm aware of His presence. And if you'll let me, I just want to take you through several verses this morning. I'll give you a little thought. I don't even know how much preaching will do. All I'm preaching off of, Brother Dean's that little post-it note. So we'll see how it goes and see how the Lord will help us. Stand with me and we'll read a few verses here. Glad I'm in church this morning.
Amen.
I wouldn't have missed this for nothing in the world. It's a good place to be. 1 Peter chapter 5, these are familiar verses. I want to lift one phrase from these verses and then show you that phrase through some of the scripture this morning. The Bible said in verse number, let's pick up reading in verse number 5. We'll take our thought from verse number 6. The Bible said, "Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another and be clothed with humility. For God resisteth," listen to this statement, "for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble." You study the scripture and you'll find that God is angry at pride. That in fact, the Bible said in Proverbs chapter number 6 and verse 16 that these six things doth the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto Him. And the first thing in that list is a proud look. There's something about pride that God absolutely despises and hates. And in fact, Peter said, you need to understand that, and if you are a proud individual, God is going to resist you, and you'll be resisted of God. God will work against you. But I'm thankful that He said that He giveth grace to the humble. There's something about the humble and those that would be lowly and walk lowly and humbly before God that God receives them, that God meets their need, that God works on their behalf, that God will give them the bestowments of His divine favor upon their life. Look with me in verse number 6 where Peter said, "Humble yourselves, therefore." Can I say we'd do well this morning to humble ourselves before God has to humble us? Somebody help me now. Don't leave me up here to myself. The Bible said that, "And pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall." And my friend, those who would live proud, they not only would be resisted of God, but God, if you are His child, will begin to work in your life. And if you don't humble yourself, God will humble you and try to knock the pride out of you in that. And notice what He said, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon Him, for He careth for you." Now I know we know verse number 7 well, but I want you to understand in the context of this passage, you can't have verse 7 without having verse 6. I'm glad that I've got a God that I can throw all my troubles and all my cares upon today. You can be seated. I'm glad today that I serve a God that is interested in the troubles and the cares and the perplexities of my life. But Gerald, you can be seated, all right? And this morning, as we think about the things that we're facing, at the crowd that Peter is writing to, they obviously knew something about having cares and about having trouble. These are, for the most part, Jewish believers. They're Hebrews that, my friend, are being persecuted and being brought to great trouble because of their faith. Evidently, as you read on down through this passage of Scripture, they not only had problems with society, but he reminds you and I that they had problems with Satan. He said that they were to be sober and vigilant because our adversary, the devil, was walking about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And he encourages them in their walk with God that they would resist him steadfast in the faith. And so their cares and their troubles were in connection with society and with Satan. That obviously all the suffering that they were in, it's a crowd of people that because of the way they live and what they believe, Brother Dane, there's been brought family suffering into their life. They've had family members who refused to convert to Christ and believe on Christ and to receive Christ and have cut them off, and they've received family suffering in this very life. Many of them have been brought to poverty and love. They had a financial suffering in their life because of their stand for Christ and their desire to walk with God. They have cares that are connected with their family life and their financial life. And you study this crowd of people, I believe we can say that there's something going on in their faith life. Over and over, Peter writes throughout this letter, and he's encouraging them in their faith, that they would not become weak in faith, that they would continue to walk with the God and be faithful to the God that has saved them and has helped them thus far. And so we come to that great verse number 7, and we rejoice, as you and I know, about dealing with society and Satan and the suffering of a faith and a family and a finances and of a multitude of other areas in our life. And I'm glad today we can cast all our care upon him, knowing today that he'd take it all, that he cares for you and me. Now, this morning, I'm not interested necessarily in that, as I am in verse number 6. How do you get to verse number 7 where you can throw all your troubles on the Lord, that you can commit all your troubles, my friend, that you've got in your hand, and give them to the Lord? Notice what he said again. He said, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. And so Peter is saying, listen, you've been brought low by the things that you're facing in life. And you're going to get to the place, you've got to get to the place where, hey man, if you're going to be exalted in due time, you've got to learn to commit them cares to the Lord, understanding that he cares for you. And the way that you get there is by humbling yourself under the mighty hand of God. I want you to consider this morning that Peter did not say, humble yourselves therefore under the hand of God. That's not what he said. He uses a descriptive word, and he said, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God. I'm glad that the hand of God is a mighty hand. Notice with me, and Peter did not say, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hands of God. He said, there's a mighty hand. He's dealing with one hand of God, and that one hand is filled with great might and strength, and is able in one hand. God is able with one hand to bear what you can't handle with two hands. And so you've got to get in the place where you humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. I'm interested in that phrase this morning, Brother Jack, on the mighty hand of God. Amen. You know this morning when you study the scripture is what you've had, is that there's a lot to be said in the Bible about the mighty hand of God. And the Bible says a lot about the hands of God. The Bible has something to say about the right hand of God. The Bible has a lot to say about what the hands of God can do and what the hands of God have done. There's a few passages in the scripture this morning that deal specifically with what Peter is dealing with this mighty hand of God. I'll give them to you quick, and then we're going to go eat some fried chicken. Somebody say amen. Amen. Deuteronomy 5. Look there. Hold your place. We'll come back to 1 Peter chapter number 5. Notice with me in the book of Deuteronomy. The book of Deuteronomy has a lot to say about the mighty hand of God. And in Deuteronomy chapter 5, look with me in verse number 15. Deuteronomy 5, verse 15. Are you there? Say amen. 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 Verse 15, the Bible said, and remember that thou, Moses is speaking to the children of Israel. He said, and remember that thou wast a servant in the land of Egypt, and that the Lord thy God brought thee out thence through a mighty hand and by a stretched out arm. Therefore the Lord thy God commanded of thee to keep the Sabbath day. And so we find here that God, through the man of God Moses, is reminding Israel where they've been. He's reminding them that they've not always had the liberty and the freedom that they enjoy today. He reminds them that there's a day and a time in their history where they're to remember that they were in bondage to that awful, dreadful place of Egypt under the hand, the mighty hand, and the strong hand of Pharaoh, the taskmaster. Notice he said, remember that thou wast a servant in the land of Egypt, and that the Lord thy God brought thee out thence through a mighty hand. You say, preacher, whose mighty hand was that? It is the mighty hand of God. Amen. What is Moses saying? What do we learn? We learn here, and it is the mighty hand of God. It sets men free from bondage. I remember today when I was lost in Messiah. I remember, but Jerry, when I was in bondage to this world and all that it had to offer, as Tim testified of a little while ago, trying to find fulfillment in a land of bondage, in a situation of slavery. I thank God one day the Lord came to where I was, and the Lord brought me out by His mighty hand. You sense the mighty hand of God that sets men free. We learn this again in Deuteronomy chapter number 9 and in verse number 26. The Bible said, I prayed therefore unto the Lord and said, O Lord God, destroy not thy people and thine inheritance which thou hast redeemed through thy greatness, which thou hast brought forth out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Is there anybody in the building this morning, you remember when you couldn't get yourself out, or where you dug and you called and you reached out, and everything you tried to do and getting yourself out only made it worse, and you wound up further down, and you wound up more unsatisfied, and you wound up in worse shape? Do you remember the day that God came back with His mighty hand, and that mighty hand reached further down than you and I could reach up? And thank God He brought us south of sin and in destruction, and my friend, a path of wickedness by His mighty hand. Thank God today for His mighty hand. His mighty hand in Deuteronomy 9:26 is linked with the greatness of redemption that is provided. And as say today, notice what he said, look at it again. Amen. I'm just trying to give you this as the Lord gives it to me this morning. But notice what he said. He said that thy people and that inheritance which thou hast redeemed through thy greatness. Did you see it there? A greatness of redemption is it used in connection with the next statement, which thou hast brought out forth out of Egypt with a mighty hand. You say, preacher, I thought they got out by the blood of the Lamb. They did. There's something about that redemption and the blood that was shed that's in connection with the mighty hand of God. And I remind you today that 2,000 years ago, at the Lord Jesus Christ, when God manifest in the flesh, he went to Calvary and obtained a great redemption for you and me. And he did it by outstretching his mighty hands and shedding blood. Amen, that you and me can be set free. I'm glad, thank God, the mighty hand of God, amen, was in work in Calvary, and was in work the day that I bowed my neck, and the Lord has brought me out and saved me, amen, by his mighty hand. Wasn't the mighty hand of my mama. It wasn't the mighty hand of my daddy. It wasn't the mighty hand of a preacher, and it was the mighty hand of God. When mama had prayed all her prayers and daddy had done all his talking and the preachers had done all their preaching, amen, at the end of the day, what made the difference was the mighty hand of God brought me out and saved my soul. And I say the mighty hand of God today at work in our lives, setting men free from bondage. And I give you another one this morning in Deuteronomy chapter number 7. Look back at page or two, Deuteronomy 7, and in verse number 19, the Bible says here, the great temptations which thine eyes saw, and the signs that Moses is talking to Israel about some things that they've been acquainted with. He said, the great temptation which thine eyes saw, and the signs and the wonders, notice it now, and the mighty hand, and the stretched out arm whereby the Lord thy God brought thee out, so shall the Lord thy God do unto all the people of whom thou art afraid. Now here's what I want you to understand from this verse again. We have the reminder that when God brought us out, how did he bring us out? He brought us out in a wonderful way. He brought us out, my friend, in a way that you and I can look back on this morning, Brother Dane, and we can say, wow, praise the Lord, his mighty hand, amen, reached down and brought me up out of all the mess that my life was in. And notice what Moses said. He said, so shall the Lord thy God do unto all the people whom thou art afraid. You know what he's saying there? He didn't just save you by his mighty hand that you're going to face some things along life's way, and there's going to be some enemies that raise up. There's going to be some battles brought into your life, and there's going to be days you tremble. There's going to be days that fear rises up and you start biting your fingernails and pulling your hair out. There's going to be days you don't know what to do. Of the same God by the same mighty hand had saved you and brought you out. Amen. He's going to reach down with his mighty hand and he's going to help you fight every battle. He's going to be there when you need him the most. I'm glad today I trusted in his hand, his mighty hand, bring me out, but I can take into the bank today. And it's the mighty hand of God that gives me victory over my enemies. Yeah, man, you say, preacher, I'm afraid today what I do. Hey, man, you just remember back the day the mighty hand of God saved you and think back to all the days you've been afraid in the past, all the battles you fought and all the battles that you've been through, saw your battle scar. And yeah, you've had a few wounds and hurts along the way, but you've lived to tell about it. You didn't make it through by your own mighty hand. You didn't make it through because you knew how to wield the sword. You made it through because the mighty hand of God helped you get through those battles. The mighty hand of God is at work and gives us victory over our enemies. I'm thankful today for the mighty hand of God. So many days in just, not just ministry, but that's my life, is ministry. So many days, Brother Brent, we've had battles and problems and things. Had the devil get on your shoulder and tell you you're never going to make it through this. Hey, man, you're not going to make it. Your ministry's done. Your church is going to fall apart. And there's no way to get through this. And my friend, I'm glad time after time after time I've learned that God has proven His mighty hand. Hey, man, we'll be faithful in the greatest hour of need. Hey, man, whatever you need today, I'm glad whatever battle you're fighting. Hey, man, if it's a battle with your flesh or a battle with the world or a battle with the devil, a battle with your family, a battle in your faith, a battle in your job, I'm glad the mighty hand of God is well able to bring you through. My friend, you'll not go under so long as the mighty hand of God is at work in your life. Can I give you another one this morning? I'm trying to get somewhere. I love this in Deuteronomy 3. This goes along, amen, with this thought of the mighty hand of God. Deuteronomy 3. And in verse number 24, I know this ain't real good preaching today, but we're working through the Bible. It's Bible preaching, amen. Watch this, Deuteronomy 3 and in verse number 24. The Bible said, O Lord God, Thou hast begun to show Thy servant Thy greatness and Thy mighty hand. I love that statement. Are y'all liking that as much as I'm liking it this morning? Moses said, Lord, I've been walking with You. I've been living my faith all these years. And Lord, Thou hast begun to show Thy greatness and Thy mighty hand. Moses is getting ready to come to the end of his life. Amen. And he's lived his life. He's walked with God. You understand the things that Moses has seen in his life, the mighty things that a mighty hand of God has done. Amen. It was Moses. It was there. Amen. Amen. He threw his rod down and it became a serpent and he picked it up and it became a rod again. Do you understand the plagues that God brought into Egypt? Moses was an eyewitness of all those things that the mighty hand of God has done. He was witness when they came to the Red Sea and it looked like he was going back to Egyptian bondage. He was there that day to see the mighty hand of God open up the Red Sea and they walked across on dry ground. Amen. Moses was there when God with His own mighty hand reached down on top of Mount Sinai and wrote the commandments down on the tablets. Moses had to be an eyewitness to so many things of the mighty hand of God. Moses, it was an eyewitness that seen the mighty hand of God every day for the last 40 years rain down and drop manna down for the people of God to eat and be fed and satisfied for 40 years. Moses has witnessed the mighty hand of God. Are y'all with me now? Did you catch what he just said? Oh Lord, thy God, Thou hast begun. Lord, I've seen some great things. Lord, I've seen Your mighty hand do so many things in my life. I've seen Your mighty hand do so many things and great things in the lives of Your people and Your children. I mean, mind-blowing things.